I'm a PhD student at social lecturer in sociology and Boston University, and I'm interested to say about investigating the emotional management of suffering during the organ donation process. I provide you with a flavour of my research. All of the presentation, we're going to talk a bit about the project. For the purposes of time, I'm not talking about my research questions, but I will discuss the methodology, talk about the transplant process, provide you with a snapshot of my findings, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about my contribution, or clinical lead contribution. So, about the project then, is to examine the ways in which the figures within the organ donation process are emotion managers. So, for example, how do organ recipient spouses, donor families, and key transplant staff manage the medical, technical, and emotional aspects of the process? The research suggests that this is done through emotion work. Through the use of emotion work, I argue that suffering is also mobilized. So, emotions and suffering are mobilized during the transplant process in order to achieve successful transplant outcomes. Suffering, for example, is construed and denied during the transplant process at certain points. So, research investigates instrumental and empathic accounts of emotions, looking at how particular boundaries are managed between the key figures. So, going on the works of Professor Sharp and Peter Sainte-Montesquieu, it is clear that there commonly exists a void between the lived experiences and everyday practices of the nation. Research so far has focused on individual aspects of the process. For example, Skew examining the life wells of kidney recipients and the waiting lists, or her research based on why donor families do or do not donate. This project focuses on the experiences of the process pre and post transplantation and has spoken to a range of people, and the research also aims to go beyond the script of So, in terms of my methodology, I got in touch with Brooks Hospital because they have a liver and kidney unit there. And this particular group is the Annual Transplant Games team, and I asked them to go there and ask them. Talking about their experiences of transplant, a group of all recipients. So that snowballed, and I felt like an honorary member of the transplant team. So I went with them to particular games, so we went to Newcastle, Bolton, and Norwich, and even participated as a supporter. And they were playing volleyball and all these different types of sports. So it was a part, it wasn't just fun, it was part of my research, and I conducted observations there as well. And I also conducted some structured interviews, and they were held either at participants' homes, in the hospital, and sometimes where participants worked as well, and that was the work. So that was really good. And 36 participants in total switched parts, so donor families, old recipients, expert staff, and also recipients as well. I'm more interested in about the transplant games, and so I took these pictures as well. And so donor families are invited to attend the games, and around the 90s when transplant games was formed, it was seen as a taboo for donor families to attend the transplant games. And now we have the option to go, and when I was at the games, I counted 8 members, 8 donor family members, and almost hundreds of organ recipients. Before I provide you with a snapshot of my findings, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the transplant process. Central organ recipients undergo various tests to see if they are eligible to go into the transplant waiting list. They must be good enough, fit enough for transplant. Once on the list, they can have their transplant at any given time and must be within 2-hour radius of the hospital. When they are called in for transplant, it is still unknown as to whether the organ will be suitable. The organ suitable transplant will take place within a number of hours. And 2 weeks after transplant, recipients are asked as to whether they would like to write a letter to their donor family to thank them for the gift of life. It's a particularly challenging and emotional time for the recipient, as letters have a strict structure and are monitored by recipient and donor family coordinators. This has got most interest from my research so far, this letter writing process. So the recipients that, so it's a sample demographic, so the recipients that took part. met lots of them in kidney and liver transplants because they are based at Andrews Hospital, which has transplanted as well. About letter writing then, the siblings had mixed feelings about letter writing and potential contact with their donor families. So from the participants that I spoke to, 5 recipients wrote a letter with no response from the donor family. 7 recipients wrote a letter with just about 1 response, and 1 recipient wrote a letter and had never with the donor family, so only 1 had left from my research. And 1 recipient had received 4 transplants, 4 kidney transplants, but had never written a letter to thank their donor family. And I did try and ask why he was at the transplant. He was at a gala dinner at the transplant school event, and he did not want to tell me, he did not want to elaborate on why he didn't write a letter. So the participants then who wrote letters received no response. Those who did not receive a response were left unsure as to whether their donor family ever wanted to hear from them. This also made recipients question possible contact in the future, and it was important for recipients that it did not upset their donor families. This situation also led recipients to imagine what their donor was like. They were saying things like, they must have been a good person to donate, before imaginary relationships with something which Leslie Sharp would call victim kinship. Quote from James, he said that it was very rural I had the transplant, but even more rural for family. I wrote a letter of thanks, but I didn't dare write it by hand. I did that within about 6 to 8 weeks after the war, and in my knowledge it was passed on. Did the family want to be bothered by me? Did they want to see me when they had just buried their relative? What was the right thing to do? And for recipients who did not want contact with the donor family, recipients feared that donor families would want to live vicariously through them. They did not want to run the risk of families being able to have a say in their lives, and what they do with their bodies, for example, what they eat or drink. Recipients were incredibly grateful for a gift of life, but for some, the thought of having contact with a donor family was too much for them emotionally. For example, Sean said, I didn't want his family to think that his family had an association with. I just didn't feel I could face that because I think it could be extremely difficult, and that's what I decided to do. I don't know if they had the letter or not. I decided that I didn't want to know, and they deal with the letter as they wish. I didn't want to know whether they had it or not. Again, if they had it and I knew about it, I wouldn't have liked to have known what they thought about it. I wanted it to end there, and that's what I did. Some recipients also asked their partners to write the letter for them, but they have never wanted to look at the response that the donor family replied, and especially if donor families had placed an image of their loved one in the letter, and the recipients refused to know any information. In one of my interviews, when I was with their recipient and the recipient's spouse, she brought the letter downstairs and was sitting in the living room, and she was hoping that she could use my interview as a way to get him to have a look at the response and to have a look at the image. He was having absolutely. It wasn't going to happen. And that's, as a researcher, that was quite an awkward situation to be in, and using it as a therapeutic sort of intervention. So that's not really the purpose of what I was doing, so that was quite difficult. And this is Alex who didn't want to talk to me about this kind of thing. So I recognise that it's probably selfish of me, but I don't know. I would have to sit and think seriously, even if they wanted contact now, after all this time. At the time, it was just one more thing on top of everything else, and it was something that I didn't have to think about, so I didn't. I won't call it baggage, because that is an unkind reflection on the donor family, but it's just something I didn't consider, and I didn't want to. There was one recipient, Lucy, who did have contact with her donor family, and this is incredibly rare, and she has had quite a lot of media coverage through her relationship with her donor family. Steady and continuous relationship, they exchange birthday cards, Christmas cards, so, and have been invited to each other's weddings, so it's a strong relationship. And she wanted to write to her dead family, but she felt like she had got her life back on track, and felt like she had something to say in terms of thanking them, and this was important for her, especially when she finished her degree, to say thank you for my gift of life, I'm able to finish my studies now. And so Jeff Barry clearly keeps meeting her, and they also live relatively close to her as well. So for Lucy, they said, could we meet you? And they came to my mum and dad's. I do remember it, I was so nervous. I mean, what can can you say? If you worry there's going to be deaf in silences, what are you going to be like? All different things go through your head, like, am I going to be good enough for them? You think, like, well, they wish they hadn't given the organ to me. I was still a quite middle class family, and are they going to be some upper class family? Do you see what I mean? That's probably why it isn't encouraged, because not everyone will be pleased with where that organ has gone. So, donor family response. So, out of the participants that I had, I was only able to speak to four donor family members, and I asked them about coming in contact with their organ. I said that they would be happy to hear from any of the organ recipients that benefited from donation. But I found it suggested that by donating, it meant that a loved one did not die in pain, but donation did not help with their grief. So, for example, Simon said, we could get in touch with them, but we're not chasing them. The organs belong to them. We have seen people meet up and behave in a strange way. If people get in touch with us, fine, but we work with them, it's their life. So, how can we make sense of this? Well, sociology, various disciplines make sense of the paradoxical nature of transplant. So, it is apparent that recipients challenge the set emotional scripts associated with transplantation. It is clear that there is a difference between public and private discussions in transplantation, and the ways in which recipients discuss their donor families. It also challenges media exceptions and current medical literature on transplant. Emotions are problematic within transplantation, and these findings can help us to think about what are deemed to be appropriate relationships between donor families and recipients. So, thinking about my contribution, I recently took part in presentation for the British Transplantation Society, and this was last month in Brighton. And NHSP2 currently are aiming to get everybody who's received a deceased donation to write a letter of thanks. And this is the time bound with things like quality management, for example, we know lots about the numbers. And I spoke alongside this team to shed light on the complexities of professionalism. And I think, in terms of contribution, that this could help best practice and to shed light on these emotional difficulties. So NHSBTU suggests that I'd like to simplify the process and have other ways of writing and thanking the donor family. So whether this is a card where they already have a set piece written in there, so they might just sign their names, I mean that would count as thanking them for that. This would be again a path forward in the draft. They want to take the onus of letter writing, because just writing, I mean, now he sits down and writes a letter, that's, you know, things like spelling, handwriting, for example. These are certain things that recipients worry about when writing these letters. And also think about, could they write an email instead? Well, simpler ways of saying thank you. So the research will also add to current literature on the sociology of health and illness, the sociology of emotions, and the sociology of suffering. Add to discussions on biosociality, the ways in which bodily knowledge, bodily materials are intimately connected to the construction of self, relationships, and bonding. I also add to the new dimension of the interrelationship discourse, this thesis suggests that if rhetoric is used in clinical practice as it fits in the narrative of donation, in practice they don't say, you know, would you like to donate a gift of life, for example, but it's used as a belief mechanism, especially for staff, as a way to help deal with the emotional demands of their job roles. And as it fits in with the narrative of organ donation as well, this also helps to explain why letter writing is also at the top of the agenda for NHSBTU. Thank you.
Does have any questions? It seems a bit brutal just to kind of cut things off.
So, yeah.
Okay. Secondly, my name is Kate, transplant coordinator. I'll be speaking very similar. The data that you've presented says that the recipients from our books are encouraged to write very early. Mm-hmm. I work with platinum transplant recipients and really wouldn't encourage anybody to write that early. So, it's quite interesting to see the difference in different organs and the difference in practice. The reason we don't ask them to write so early is because they have high-dose steroids on board, which means that they have heightened emotions, it can cause depression, it can exacerbate anxiety, so therefore we absolutely ask them to wait until they've at least been back to all the patients for their first visit. We also ask them to write proof of their donor details. these sort of sub-information that they can form their lecture around. So it's quite interesting to see how all the centres are managing this.
I just wanted to ask, so you said NHSBT are encouraging this, are they wanting more of that experience and that? Why do you think that is? I mean, especially because your research shows that in some senses there can be kind of some damage done through that process.
So why do they want this to happen? Well, my interpretation of that is, again, it's about quality control, quality management. So there are, for us, how many letters are being written at particular centres. And I think as well, it's about showing that people are thankful and grateful.
But it kind of is intention, there is the notion that it's supposed to be altruistic.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's a lot of kind of issues going on there. Because Leslie Sharp brings about the letters, didn't she? She brings about how they're very tightly controlled.
Yes. Yeah. So I think they're trying to take the formality away from letter writing and other means. Again, like one suggestion was a card that had already had everything written in it, so they might just sign a name. But again, it counts as another thank you. I think they want this to be a part of the process. That's an interesting question.
Yeah, and I think we'll talk a lot more about letter writing too. Ewe's piece there and my installation here were both very much about letter writing, and in Canada, where processes in a way can be more formal, and people write their letters, and then anything that they've said which might identify them or might be too kind of strong is literally redacted from the letters. So the process is highly controlled.
Well, what we've discussed in the group is actually having help and support to write those letters. I have a friend whose daughter died, and six organs were donated to her death. She's heard from all of the recipients, except for one, over a 5-year period. But she's highly articulate, and she's very dissatisfied with the quality of the letters. Even though she's received them all, it's almost impossible to get right.
But it's such a hyper-emotive situation.
Yeah.
Is there a particular kind of format which they have to adhere to? Particular ones like a 10-minute class? You have to say how you're doing on the transcript.
So there's, they have lists of what they're doing in the letter. So they can choose plans. There's the mapping to emotional mapping 2011 to give away their identity. So it's quite my own personal letter.
Oh, that's a season of my life.
I was just wondering whether there's been any research looking at the donors themselves and the procurement agencies around what the meaning of the letters is to them.
I'm not too sure.
It's just so maybe that's an
experience. So we research on this, and there was nothing from the donation point of view. Mm-hmm. But being a recipient coordinator, it's quite interesting to see some of these patients who are more difficult to manage after transplant as recipients, to then read their letters. There's certainly one checking out in it. I think it would be useful to share that with the staff to show that it does have a more gentle side.
So Andrea's here, and she's a recipient of our heart, and she wants to say something.
I'm writing a dissertation, an undergraduate dissertation, on cultural frameworks that make transplantation possible. I was just going to ask you, do you think there's almost an emotional sensory, sensory is too much emotion. Do you think the sort of cultural avoidance of emotion and perhaps a fear that the expression of emotion might even challenge the cultural framework in which organization is built?
Interesting question. Yeah, I think that this is okay, that makes me think about my research, harnessing emotions and denying some of these processes is about successful organ transplant outcomes. That's my
denial of the emotions.
personal. We can't discuss a lot of genetic information about sequencing donor families. And it makes me think about, so why is it like this for this type of donation, but for other types of donation?
Can I just help with my use of the situation? How's for you and social department and social deliberate ignorance around they're very about deliberate ignorance around organ donation in Denmark amongst health professionals because of the ways in which they were referring specifically to how brain dead donors were resuscitated sometimes in order to prove that people want to donate. But they wrote about how sometimes these kind of really very aggressive forms of practice in organ donation, health professionals really had to stop themselves from thinking too much about it in order that they could then go on to do the practice. So
there's also actually from our project, which is I'm not sure if anyone mentioned this, but it's focused around video interviews with first of all the first tranche with recipients and now with donor families, and that's really fascinating because it's really based on what people are prepared to say, and then examining what their body language says, which is actually much more revealing sometimes about what their actual emotions are and what they're actually feeling.
Yeah, there seems to be a definite split between the narrative and the words and then the body, mind and body split.
Yeah.
Here it's within health recipients, particularly in various ways.
Yeah. Laura, last question.
I just think it's trying to follow the theme of thinking across the patch. Gamete donors have to write have the option to write goodwill messages to any offspring that are a result of their donations. And they can also write a personal statement to give a drawing of themselves, short, frizzy hair, that kind of thing if they want to. They don't even receive any help with that, official support available with that. Have you made any comparisons between the literature with you writing about organ donors and the recipients and letter writing and gamete donors and letter writing?
I haven't yet.
I'm giving you a minor question here. I will just say that the plan for the thesis last chapter is going to be based on letter writing. And we'll look at comparison between. I think if you just make even the slightest reference to gamete and the lack of support available to connect, it would really bring out how advanced what we're doing and what is happening in the donation and the writing. Because I think there will be a gap in the information.
Has anybody written about the letter writing for gamete donation?
Yes. Eric Blythe. Phil is now retired, I think, as an academic social policy. Maybe Nina. I think Eric Lyne and Ken Daniels and Eric Hayes. That's Seth. I'm going to get from maybe no more. Anybody else? Eric Hayes. About the letter writing in gamete donation.
Oh, no, I don't
know. I think that would be Eric Lyne would be much better.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Stephanie. Thank you.